Broadcasting live from the Norman B. Murray Community Center in the heart of beautiful Mission Viejo, it's Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, featuring special guest, sax man extraordinaire, Najee.
Welcome to Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, everybody. Glad that you're here with us this morning. This is a very fun one today. Very
fun
one
today. Fun.
Exactly. By the way, hello, Oslo. Hello, Oslo.
Norway.
We're big in Oslo. Who knew? Go figure, huh?
And he's Norwegian, too.
Yampin-yampin-y. What? Did I break a nail?
Sorry.
All right. Y'all have this in your collection?
Say yes.
You should. You really should.
If not, I think we have some for sale, right?
Yeah, we do.
This is
CD number 15 for our guest today. We're thrilled to have him here. He is two-time Grammy nominee. He's performed at the White House, played at the birthday party for Nelson Mandela, and we have got him here on our stage this morning.
And he was at the Bash last year, too.
Yes, he was.
He was at our KSBR birthday bash on our stage.
Exactly right. We're going to hear all about all that stuff. Mm-hmm. But he's going to play for us too. Please welcome, ladies and gentlemen, Najee.
Thank you. Brian.
Wow.
All right.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Stick around. We're going to take a break. Come back. We got Najee all hour here on Mission Viejo Television. Welcome back to Breakfast with Gary Kelly here. Najee, look, it's Najee.
It's Najee.
How are you, man?
I'm doing great. Good. Thanks for having me here.
Oh, I'm so glad to have you. This is a great thing.
A special treat.
I'm honored. Thank you.
Look at the crowd we got.
Yeah, it's something.
People love Najee, man. I'm telling you, you're doing double duty today. This is a long day for you. I know you were saying before you don't like musicians that whine.
That complain. I hate musicians that complain.
Aww.
I got to go do another gig. Really?
Really?
What
else do you have going today?
The Long Beach Jazz Festival.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, I'm playing on there tonight.
Very nice.
Yeah, so
okay. Well, thank you for getting up so early and coming out to our little breakfast.
Oh, I'm honored to be here, believe me.
I have to tell you, I was really confused about where you permanently reside.
I mean,
you have a place here, or do you, or
no. Not anymore. I lived here for about 10 years, and now I reside in Florida. So
there you go.
Right outside of Disney area.
Ooh,
nice.
Yeah, I moved there in 2001 and love it.
Yeah, but you're a New York guy.
I grew up in New York City, born and raised. I came from an area. Well, I was born in Manhattan. In Greenwich Village, and when I was about 11 years old, we moved to Queens. So I always say I'm from Jamaica, Queens. Same, Marcus Miller and I actually grew up in the same area. You know,
nothing like it.
Huh?
There's nothing like it.
Nothing like it. No.
Yeah, it's amazing. I was actually just there. I had to go back last weekend and went Saturday through the 9/11 Memorial Museum.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Yeah, it's beautiful though. They did a great job.
Oh, it's phenomenal. It's phenomenal. Were you in the city? Did you live there when that happened?
I was actually here, and I was here the morning it happened. I went back a few days when they allowed people to fly back. And, you know, growing up in New York City, I can remember when the towers went up. You could actually, in my house in Queens, in the attic where my room was, you could see, you know, when they built the tower. So for the average New Yorker, for those who've been there, you know, when you grow up seeing that, that's always going to be in your mind, even till this day, even though they built the Freedom Tower.
Mm-hmm.
You can never get out of your mind the two towers there.
Wow.
You know? And back then, years before that, there was a station called CD 101.9. Pat Prescott came from that station in New York, and we used to do concerts at the World Trade Center. Every summer they had a concert series, and I was part of that series back then.
Oh, how nice.
Yeah. I think Tony Guerrero and I played there too.
That's right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Crazy. So when did you come out here?
Came out here, I want to say 96. I think it was 96. Well, actually, I was married. You know how it goes with us musicians. We meet the nice girl, we fall in love. She was from California, I was from New York, so of course I had to move to California. And ended up moving to the Bay Area. And then, you know, when that all disbanded, we had two beautiful children who are grown now. I came down here to Southern California, so I lived here. And then I decided.
Huh? The music scene.
Yeah, exactly.
That's where it's at. Yeah.
Well, what started your musical career? When did you, like...
Oh, did I tell you that story earlier?
No, you haven't told me anything.
Okay, I've told somebody a story.
No, I want to know, when did it all start for you?
Well, it started as a kid.
Were your parents musically inclined?
My father played violin, but not professionally.
Okay.
You know, when I was in elementary school, I got exposed to the saxophone. Gentleman came to our school and he played, I'll never forget the song, Desafinado, which was, I think it was a Stan Getz song. And I was so impressed that he could play a song on the radio, right? But I loved the sound of the saxophone. And then when I got in junior high school, I began playing clarinet.
Mm-hmm.
Only because the saxophone chairs were taken. And back
the
then,
chairs?
Yeah, meaning that, you know, you...
There's no place to sit.
Well, they put me in with the girls, which ultimately was not so bad.
Clarinet, I took the clarinet in eighth grade.
Exactly.
Yeah, I remember that.
So my teacher, he said, listen, you play clarinet, you can always switch to saxophone. And that's what I did.
Okay.
But I had love for aviation. So when high school came, I went to an aviation high school, which was called August Martin High School in Jamaica, Queens, New York. But one event that happened, which was a life-changing event for me. True story.
Tell me.
I was playing in the high school band, and took my first solo, and after that solo, all the girls knew my name. Career change right away. That was it.
Wow. Now, is your name really Najee?
That's my middle name, yes.
Okay. Yes. So did you go
I'm
by?
I'm not going to tell you my first name, because anybody put Najee in, it's going to come up. So I'm not even going to embarrass myself. Najee is my middle name. And, you know, when my career first started in the late 80s, you know, that was when the one name thing, Kenny G dropped. Gorlick,
yeah, and right, Kennedy, exactly.
Sade, you know, yeah. And then they were the record company's like Najee, you know.
That's awesome. That's how it's been. So you're just Najee. Mm-hmm.
That sounds sexy.
Sounds man. Like.
You sound good saying it. Najee. Don't she?
French. It sounds a little French.
Oh, I like that.
Oui, oui, Najee.
There you go again, man. That sax thing is that sax thing is still working for you, isn't it?
Hey. I want to just say oui, oui, Najee. That's good.
Yes.
That's good. Right. So when you started playing, well, I told you, I'm going to pretend I don't know anything about you. So when you started playing the saxophone and you were in high school,
yes.
What made you decide to make this a career?
Well,
was it that changing thing with the girl thing?
No, no. Actually,
there's got to be more to it.
Well, actually, I was in a band, an R&B band, and we started playing little gigs around the neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
And one gig in particular in my neighborhood, the health department of New York City was promoting condoms.
I knew I was going to get a good story.
True story.
Well, that's a hell of a gig right there.
So, yeah, you know, we're in this
I'm trying to picture the poster for that show.
Well, you should have seen how we feel. We didn't even show you how naive we were. We go in there and we thought there were balloons on the wall. They had blew up condoms on the wall. Right? But I'll never forget, here I am, 15-year-old kid, and I made $40 for that gig. That was a lot of money for a kid back then. I was like, oh man, you can get girls and you can make money too.
This and get free condoms.
And get free condoms, exactly.
True story though. But all throughout high school, I played in local bands. That was my pastime, mm-hmm. That's what we did. We played in bands and we competed with each other. There was battle of the bands back then in
sure.
New York. And then I had a summer job where we would actually go around the city in different boroughs and put on shows in the summertime.
Okay.
We made money from the city of New York doing this stuff. And it just evolved, and then after high school, I went on my first world tour for the USO, playing all around the world.
Right out of high school?
Right out of high school. I was in a band called Area Code, that was the name of the band. And we were a funk R&B band.
Sweet.
So we went on the road, we toured all over Europe, Latin America, parts of Asia.
To the troops and everything.
Right, to the troops.
Did you at that point have any expectation that you would get booked, that band would get booked for anything like that? Or, I mean, clearly, if you did, I mean, you had been winning a lot of those battles of the bands, right?
Right, right. Well, you know, it was just one of those things that just fell in love. We actually went out backing up Miss America, Miss Black America at the time.
Yeah.
And she was a singer, songwriter, a whole bit, dancing. We went out backing her up. And our first gig was in Frankfurt, Germany.
And you got paid for this.
We got well,
somewhat. Know. But you got a free trip to go all over the place.
We might have made $100 a week or something.
But still going on the road.
So it was a full lesson in the music business.
It was,
yeah,
but
right?
You know what? For a kid, 18 years old, that was a lot of money.
Oh,
for me.
Yeah.
So,
plus,
you know,
the world.
Seeing the world was really the most important thing. It changed my life. And then I came back, went to school. I came back and went to Bronx Community College in New York in the music department under the legendary Valerie Capers.
Okay.
And then after a year of doing that, I decided to audition for New England Conservatory of Music to study with Joe Allard.
Ooh la la.
Who's taught John Coltrane, Michael Brecker, all these great saxophonists.
Yeah.
Yeah, so. And then couldn't afford to go, quit. Then went on the road with Chaka Khan for, you know, and that was in.
Chaka Khan.
Yeah, right. That was the Ain't Nobody tour.
Oh my gosh.
The rest was history.
So how did you go from Chaka Khan to actually writing music and producing CDs? Because this is what, number 15?
15, I believe so, yeah. Something like that. Yeah.
So how did you just started writing songs? And
well, after Chaka's gig, Ain't Nobody tour, Ain't Nobody had a gig. So. So I'm scrounging around New York City playing gigs. I mean, I'm playing keyboards as a back, you know, second keyboard player in different bands. And one young lady that was in the band with Chaka was Melissa Morgan, mm-hmm. great R&B vocalist. She's actually on this record.
Oh.
She sang background with Chaka, and she got signed to Capitol Records, did her first album, went gold, the whole bit. And she invited me to play on the record. And her manager at the time, who was married to the legendary Melville Moore, he said to me, man, I didn't know you played saxophone. I thought you were a keyboard player. I'm like, no, I'm a sax and flute player. That's what I do. He said, well, I got this slot. You know, I want to sign a jazz artist. I said, okay. He said, so bring me some material. And I did that.
Okay.
And the rest was history. I brought him the material. They put it out. And I didn't even realize that, you know, it would have been so big. Because what I did was an R&B record. They called it jazz.
Uh-huh.
And I'm a jazz musician, so I, you know, for me it was R&B. Yeah. I was going for that audience. And in 3 months, we had my first gold album. And I didn't realize what that meant, how naive I was. You know, I was signed to Capitol EMI Records. And you know when you go to Capitol Building, everybody's got a gold record. So I thought it was just a formality.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
You
know,
I didn't realize
everybody else has. It's like, yeah, whatever.
Yeah, you know. I didn't realize that meant you had a real career, you know?
Yeah.
And I'm walking in airports, I'm on the front cover of Billboard, I'm on the front cover of USA Today, and I'm
like, who is that?
You know, and people are like, Najee, you know me? I was totally surprised. You know, so.
You know, I got to tell you, you're making this sound like it was awful easy.
Oh, no, it was not.
You know what I mean? It's like, oh, yeah, I did this, and then that happened. You know, I went to USO, and then Shaka Khan.
Man.
I mean, to go on the road with Shaka Khan, that had to be a completely eye-opening experience. I mean,
it was.
Were you
was.
On a bus?
Who else was in the band?
Yeah, we were. At the time, Tony Maiden from Rufus was
in
there.
Oh, yeah. Oh.
My brother Fareed played guitar. Gary Haas on bass. Melissa Morgan was one of
sure.
Vesta.
Oh.
The late Vesta. She was in the band as a background singer. So there were quite a few people. Matt Gallahan was from David Duke.
It must have
Blues
been a really
band.
Big
yeah.
bus.
It was a great, yeah, it was a lot of fun.
And
but
you
we
were
did
how
a lot
old?
Of growing up.
How old?
At that time, I think it was 23, 24.
Oh, man. Mm-hmm.
And then there was, of course, Shaka.
Shaka, yes. Who I love dearly. I have no bad Shaka stories. I mean, I know.
Any
you
funny?
Want bad stories,
any funny Shaka stories?
I have some great ones, yes.
But tell us a really
some of them
good.
Are, well, I'll give you
no,
one.
A G-rated funny
you
one.
You want to hear one of those?
Yeah, a real funny one.
Well, for some reason, we had this road manager that really treated the band terribly.
Aww. Right?
And for whatever reasons, the band felt my brother and I could be the spokesman. We get to New Orleans one day, and Shaka knows something's going on. She calls us to the hotel room in her room, and she says, what's going on? So we tell her the story, you know, the road manager, blah, 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 blah. Call her in here right now. She comes in. My band does not get, and I've been a road musician. You don't treat my band. We're sitting there like,
you're in big trouble, right?
Almost got her fired, you know?
Oh,
but she was
no.
that kind of person that she really cared about the people that worked for her.
Aww.
Nice.
Yeah,
nice.
Love her for that. I learned a lot from her.
She's an amazing talent.
She really is.
Absolutely yeah. amazing talent.
Very
that
nice.
That had to be a great growth period for you musically.
It was. And, you know, because, I mean, she was a legend by the time we got in the band. And when we got there, we were very green. We, you know, I mean, we were kids from New York.
Yeah.
Young kids, you know, and here we are with this legend. She just had all these all-star names with Michael Brecker and David Sambor. You know, she did this live album. We're like, why are we here? You know? So, but she treated us very well. She
man.
Did.
Wow.
I mean, you really have worked with an amazing roster of people.
I know.
Talk about... And it's funny how many people have actually been on the show that have worked with Prince. I
yes.
mean, but mm-hmm. oh my God! I mean, what is going on with this guy? He's unbelievable,
he
isn't
is.
He?
He is. He's great. Another one I never would imagine I would have ever worked with. But tell you a quick story. Some of you have heard this on the radio, but when I was living here in L.A., I get this call from a rapper you all probably heard of named Dougie Fresh.
Ah.
And you know he's from New York, so you know how we talk
yeah.
in New York. He's like. Yo, the artist is looking for you.
The artist?
That's what he says. The artist is looking for you. I said, okay. He said, he's going to call you shortly. So I get this call about 10 minutes later from this guy. He says, Najee? I said, yeah. He says, the artist would like to speak to you. So I'm like looking at the phone like, yeah, okay, all right.
Do you know who the artist is at this point?
Right, you know, back then he wasn't using Prince. He had some problem with Warner Brothers anyway. So I said, okay, he's gonna call you back. Click. 5 minutes later, same guy, Najee, I have the artist on the phone. I'm like,
wow.
Okay, all right. So then he says, he gets on the phone, he says, yo man, what's up? Now I'm from New York. Right? So I'm like, I don't know, what's up? He says, when are you and I getting together? So now you can imagine what I'm thinking at this point. I'm like, when are we getting together?
Do you know who this is by this point?
Yeah, of course.
So you know it's Prince on
yes,
the other
Yes, absolutely.
Line. Okay.
So now, you know, I'm looking at the phone, you know, wondering what kind of question is this, you know?
Trick question.
When are we getting together? I said, I don't know, you tell me. He says, what are you doing right now? I'm starting to really freak out now, right? I'm telling you.
Are you thinking musically or something else?
Well, I didn't know what to think. I mean, you know what I mean? I was a victim of the press like everybody else, right? So he's, I said, I don't know. You tell me. He says, well, why don't you come out to Minneapolis? I'm like, when? He says, like, come out right now. I'm like,
it's going to take.
I can't come out right now. He said, when can you come out?
Where were you, in L.A.?
Yeah, I was in L.A. Okay. So I said, I don't know, maybe about 4 days. He says, all right, I'll call you back. Click. So now I'm really, you know, I mean, he just sets up this real tense atmosphere.
Yeah.
About 4 days later, I go out to Minneapolis, my brother and I. We get out there, and it ends up being a greater thing. And about every night, he'll call you at 12 midnight. Somebody will call you and say, the artist would like to do a jam session at 2 a.m. You're like, really, player? We go 2 a.m., we're doing these jam sessions. After about a week, he comes to me, he says, you know what, I want you to join the MPG. I got a two-week tour. Do this album with me, and we'll go out for 2 weeks. That ended up being 3.5 years.
Oh, my goodness.
Wow.
Unbelievable.
Nice.
That's great. Yeah.
Nice.
Boy, he is just sick talent. Unbelievable.
Incredible.
You know what, I gotta get me a phone guy like that. You know, I gotta get one of them guys, you know, call that guy, tell him I'm gonna be calling him. You know, I didn't want, how do you put that on your resume?
But you can't
say. I was Prince's phone guy.
Oh, yeah,
what did that mean? Well, I'd call people up and say, Prince is gonna be calling you.
Right. Oh, yeah.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. We are, we're gonna take a break and come back and let Najee do his thing here with his horn. Stick around here on Breakfast with Gary and Kelly.
All right.
Nice. That's funny. Welcome back to Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, everybody. Look at we're spending the morning here with Najee. Mm-hmm. This is just, you know, because I just happened to have this in my hand.
Great.
The morning after a musical love story, Najee's 15th CD. You need to get this. You need to do that.
You have them for sale here?
Yes, we do.
Oh, we've got them for sale here?
Exactly.
You
and you could probably get them in Oslo, too. Hi, Oslo. But Najee, we're blowing up Oslo this morning. I don't know why. Introduce us to this gentleman over here, please.
Yes. Who is this?
Well, this is a friend of mine I've known for many years. His name is Nick Smith. Thank you.
Yeah.
Nick, thank you for being here this morning. Thank you for being here.
And he's played with people like Larry Carlton, Stanley Clark toured with him for many, many years. I've had the pleasure of working on and off with him.
So you can't hold down a job, Nick? Is that what you're saying?
No.
But he was kind enough to come and do this for free.
Yeah, there you go. See? Okay, I'll shut up now.
This is my brother right here.
What are you going to play for us?
We're going to do a song. Actually, I recorded a song. I studied with the legendary Jimmy Heath as a kid at Jazzmobile in New York.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the songs that he wrote and recorded was called Sound for Sore Ears, and I recorded it on an album called The Smooth Side of Soul.
Oh.
So we're going to play that.
All right.
Najee, everybody.
Najee.
Thank you. Nick Smith.
Wow. You guys are good. Very good.
That's the real deal right there. Oh, wow. Yeah. Oh, my goodness gracious.
I felt like I was in a nightclub somewhere. Oh, yeah. You know?
That's terrific, man.
All I needed like was like the red lights and good a little stuff, smoke man. In the room.
Good stuff. You did another one? You got another one in for us right now?
Oh, sure.
Yeah?
We'll squeeze one out.
Maybe do some flute.
Ooh, a flute.
Yeah.
I saw you on the stage at the birthday bash with
your
flute. Yes, I did.
The world needs more.
You know what? I had to. There were so many great saxophone players that I was like, you know what? I'm not even going to try to compete with all that.
Oh, man. I was walking by and I thought, there's a man with a flute up there. Look at that.
We had Michael Linkton. We had.
I know.
Mindy was there.
Yeah, Rick Braun.
Rick Braun, everybody.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, I'm just.
But he had the flute and I noticed. And I thought, there's a man up there with a flute.
Very nice. What are we going to hear, man?
We're going to do a Joe Henderson tune. Oh, this is called Roll Recorder May. And I'm going to tell you a real quick story about the flute.
Please. Ooh, yes.
When I was a kid, I was about 15, and Christmas Eve, we were rehearsing for a New Year's gig at my hometown, New York. And I grew up in Jamaica, Queens, New York, right? You know, okay.
There you go.
Funky for Jamaica, right? But anyway.
That's right.
So after the rehearsal, the guys are like, man, don't take your horns home because, you know, I was a little kid. And you know, back then we had those big coffin cases for instruments, and they were like, don't take your horns home, we don't want nothing to happen to you. So just leave them here at the rehearsal studio. And I did. Christmas Day, they come to me, they say, we got bad news for you. I'm like, what? They said, your horns were stolen. So for like a year, all I had was the flute.
Oh, well, there you go.
So here I go.
That was
there
a good thing. Yeah, there you go.
Because you took the flute home.
I took the flute home.
Yeah, all right.
All right, this is recorded, man. Sit up. Thank you.
Very nice.
Thank you, sweetheart. Thank you.
Very nice. Thank you. 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 Thank you.
Oh,
thank you so much. Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, everybody.
I think they like you.
We're here with Najee and Kelly's shoes.
My
Look
shoes.
Look at that. Nice.
Hey, you
Kelly,
know.
Najee, Kelly just got an endorsement deal with Tom McCann, so it's
really
working out great.
Stop.
You hook a brother up or what? What's up?
Well, we could talk, you know. Yours are pretty shiny there, mister.
I know, man, you know.
Wow. But you know what? Comfort is all.
For me, it is.
Yeah, those look comfortable, Kelly. Those really, when you think comfort, that's the kind of shoe you're talking about right there.
Stop. I have a question about your flute.
Yes.
To go from a saxophone to a flute, is it hard to switch like that as far as the notes are concerned? I mean, I'm assuming the notes will be the same, but, you know, the position of your fingers and how you blow and all that stuff.
It is. Well, it's a different mindset.
Okay.
You know, I don't know why, but a lot of professional players have been asking me questions about flute.
Yeah.
You know, like Darren Ron and, you know.
What do they want to know?
Huge groove. We did a show in Atlanta a couple weeks ago. He said, man, will you give me flute lessons? I was like, really?
Flute lessons?
He said that. I was like.
Really?
I don't know what I would teach you, you know.
But, so what's the difference between like.
Well, the problem we sax players face is we approach the flute like a saxophone and it's really its own instrument. It's probably, for me, it's more difficult than saxophone, to be honest.
I was just going
to
say, because even like, you know, where you put your hands and your. It doesn't have a reed, right?
No.
Okay.
No.
I don't know these
things. It's a different.
I have no musical bone in my body. I can't even sing. Seriously. I tried to play a clarinet when I was in eighth grade, and that didn't work. So.
No, that's a great thing. Are you playing that on Paul Brown's new one, right?
Yes, I am.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Great record. Yeah.
Yeah.
He's a special cat.
He is.
He knows what he's doing.
He came down to Florida, and I happened to be at home, and I went out and played with him. You know, just showed up. People didn't know I was coming, and we had a blast. I mean, it was fun.
Yeah, that's great. Let's I want to talk about another part of your career. Your movie career.
No, I never worked a strip club.
Your movie career.
Oh, my
Remember
movie career.
Remember this one, ladies and
gentlemen?
Oh, my God. You got this deal.
What
from
is that?
1990, it's Death by Temptation.
Really?
Now, for those of you who are not from New York, you know, when something was nice, you know, where I grew up, people say, yo, that was death. They say death, but it really, you know.
And that means a good thing.
Nice,
so Death by Temptation was a film I did.
Oh, death.
Yeah.
Oh.
Well.
I thought he said death.
I'm in
like,
it.
Wow.
But.
You play yourself, though.
I do.
What do you?
Because I don't play anything. All I do is stand there and hold the saxophone over this terrible song. But I was great for the opportunity.
Did you get,
the movie is great.
Are you getting royalties from this?
I don't even know, to be honest with you. I don't know.
Was it on the big screen?
Yeah.
You know,
for a week, maybe?
Thing, yeah, for a little while.
I
think it's out on DVD. People buy it.
Who was the big star in that
one? The big star ended up being Samuel Jackson. And I think
Kadeem Hardison was in it. Kadeem Hardison was great.
How'd you get that gig?
You know, I don't even remember, other than my manager, you know, who was really a brilliant marketer at that time. He said, go do this movie. I'm like, okay.
Okay.
You know, you'll be really happy to know we have a clip.
We do.
Oh, you're going to do this to
me, Garrett. Check it out. This is a Death by Temptation.
Are we playing it?
Look, man, when she drinks that holy water, she's going to start slobbering and farting and gagging.
Nice, huh?
Well, I was in a Robert De Niro film.
Is that right?
Yeah, my part could make.
That's a real movie.
I was in one.
What did you do on that movie?
I played. It was directed by the legendary Erwin Winkler, and you know he was a Dexter Gordon fan. He loved Dexter Gordon at the time. Dexter had just passed on, and he asked me to play a jazz standard of Dexter Gordon's in this movie called Guilty by Suspicion.
Nice.
And I played my part, and I went to the movies, and I was terribly hurt that I didn't see my part in it.
Oh, did you get cut out?
I was big cut out, man.
Well, I see a theme go, death by temptation.
Guilty by...
Guilty by...
Suspicion?
Suspicion. Oh, what terrible. Do you think the next one's going to be?
I don't know. I have no
idea. Let's
make
it a happy one.
Well, that was the end of my Hollywood career. As we can.
Well, look, we can make a couple of phone calls and, like, you know, happy with joy.
Well,
you know?
Yeah, there you go. There you
well,
go,
wait yeah. a minute. Maybe not.
But, you know, we...
Well, good.
Can we talk a little bit about this, your 15th CD? It's a great one, and one of the things I know you touched on is a tribute to the late, great George Duke.
George Duke,
my
yes.
goodness, what a... Mm.
Yes,
what do we need to know and remember about George Duke?
Well, I think he was one of the greatest legends of our time.
Yeah.
But the world has, for some reason, overlooked that, you know? I mean... You know, I don't know. I hope that one day maybe the smooth jazz industry will develop its own need or urgency for preserving some of the history of some mm-hmm. of the great people, such as he himself, Al Jarreau, all bunch of legends. I mean, but here's a man who went between jazz, classical, and R&B, and had so many great hits, working with so many great artists, from Jeffrey Osborne to Denise Williams to... Diane Reeves, Rochelle Farrell, and many, 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 many mm-hmm. others.
Zappa.
Yeah, right, Frank yeah. Zappa. He started with Frank crazy. Zappa. He played yeah. with Miles Davis, Cannonball Adderley, you know, the great Al Jarreau.
Yeah.
I was very fortunate to have him produce a couple of my CDs as well. Song from the Key of Life, which was a special project, my last album on Capitol EMI, and he brought in all the original members of Stevie Wonder's.
Oh, is that right? I wasn't aware of that. Oh,
yeah,
my
goodness. So we had... we had Ndugal Chancellor, we had Herbie Hancock come in and play.
Oh, nice.
Stanley Clarke and Michael Cimbello on guitar. I mean, it was just a great project.
Dude, what kind of pressure is that when you get those kids?
Well, you know, I'm sitting there like, I can't believe these guys are playing for me. I mean, Herbie Hancock, I'm sitting there, the very first time I ever played with him, he came to I'm hiring this guy. And mm-hmm. he was in Europe, so we couldn't get hold of him. And George says to me, he says, listen, man, we're going to have Herbie come in and play. I'm like, why we need Herbie? We got you. You
know? Yeah, so, really?
But he said, no, you're going to want Herbie on this. So about 2 weeks we couldn't
find
him. Couldn't find him. As fate would have it, I'm walking on a flight in New York to come out here, and who's sitting right there in the first seat when I walk on the plane?
Oh, you're kidding me.
Herbie. And I walk up, I'm like, man, you playing on my record or what? You know?
Oh,
oh my God.
Well, that's, and you know, and all the people are looking at him like,
really?
You playing this guy's record or what?
Yeah, know? What are you doing?
So he said, man, I'm sorry, I've been in Europe, I was touring, you know, but I'm gonna come in tomorrow. So anyway, the session is set for 2 p.m. in the afternoon. George and I are there. Herbie shows up 2 a.m. the next morning.
Well, he got the 2 o'clock, right?
Right, he got the 2 great.
Yeah.
Places the bottle of cognac on the piano, starts playing the track, and I'm listening, and I'm like, and George can see the concern on my face, because you know, Herbie is such an advanced musician. Any musician that plays with Herbie, you can never have a bad note, because wherever you are, he's going to find a chord to support you. So you're going to sound great.
Aww.
On this particular date, he's there, he's playing, and I'm like, wow, man, this is so harmonically advanced. I don't see how we can use it. So Gerald's is like, don't worry about it, man. I got you. We're going to use my track, but we're going to use his solo. And it was an amazing solo. And so that's how we got him on the record, you know. But George was that kind of guy. You could just make a call and people show up. The very first time I played with Quincy was because of George. You know? Yeah, he brought me over to Montreal, Switzerland.
We were in talks with George to have him on our show.
Great man.
Yeah. And it was just like, oh.
No doubt. So. The thing that, the release that they put out, he and Jarreau, those tapes from back in the day in San Francisco when they were just playing that little club gig.
Yes.
Have you heard it?
I haven't heard it yet. I heard about it, though.
Phenomenal.
He just released them.
It's so fun. I mean, it was just, you know, he had a reel-to-reel running under a piano in this little club.
Really?
You know, this is, oh, yeah, and it's like 67 or something. You know, they're just like...
Fillmore.
You can hear him laughing in the background.
This is in some little nightclub in where they had a regular gig. And, I mean, they were just recording them. And he found these reel-to-reel tapes.
Oh, that's wonderful.
And they cleaned them up and put it out. It is just magic. It's just, and, you know, it's music, and then it's them talking about, remember what was going on then?
Laughing and joking on.
It's this piece of history.
Wow, that's wonderful.
Oh, it's unbelievable. Yeah, it's unbelievable. Great. Talk about Quincy. My goodness.
Quincy Jones.
The Forrest Gump of music. I mean, the guy's everywhere.
He's so much fun. I remember the very first time I worked with him was in Montreal, and I don't remember the year, it was in the late 90s, and I was so nervous. So I get over there, and I'm thinking, you know, he's going to have me do like smooth jazz, contemporary jazz stuff. He pulls out a straight ahead chart. He says, this is the song you're playing. And he pairs me up with I think it was George Duke, Ron Carter, Toots Thielman, the harmonica player, and I forget who was on drums, and we're playing straight ahead. And I was honored that he thought enough of me to do that because, wow. You know, I mean,
oh, yeah.
I thought
yeah.
he was just going to have me come over and do what, you know, we normally do.
Yeah, yeah.
But no, he featured me on traditional jazz stuff, which was nice. To be paired up with Ron Carter, you know, and people like that was amazing to me.
Crazy, just crazy.
Larger well, than life.
Nice man.
I want to hear yeah. about the real quick story when you had your first CD out.
Oh, yes.
Where were you when you heard it on the radio?
Oh, I'll never forget it. I was, at the time, my girlfriend at the time, we were riding home, and in New York, there was a station called WBLS 107.5 WBLS.
Hey, you got a good radio voice.
Yeah, everybody wants the really cool gig in the radio. That's the
well. And we were driving, it was, you know, it had the Quiet Storm format, which was a late night radio thing. And, you know, we had a very famous on-air jock named Vaughn Harper. So everybody, he had a signature voice.
Oh, yeah.
The next thing he goes, he says, we have Najee playing Sweet Love.
And you heard this?
Oh, my God. I almost fell out. I mean, I was just, it was just amazing to me, you know. Here I'm hearing myself on the radio under my own name. I've had played with other artists.
Right.
But, you know, I was like, wow.
What'd your girlfriend say?
Oh, I think she was probably counting the checks, but it, see if I can get my hooks in this guy for real. Of course, he's no longer around. But.
Oh, you're silly.
So here, let me ask you. So what's the answer for the music business now? I mean, what's going to happen? I mean, is everybody just there's no money anymore? It's just what are you going to do? Just
they're not bad, in it for bad. The money, Gary. Don't you know right. that?
Well, you got to pay your bills. You got to eat. You know what?
Well,
it's crazy, isn't it?
It
well,
is. It's a different game now. You know, I mean, when I started, I was fortunate that the timing was just right for me. You know, and many other artists. I mean, that was when record companies actually spent money on the artists.
Mm-hmm.
And I came up in the big machine.
Yeah,
so, you know, I hear artists today, and no disrespect to any of them, but, you know, I hear they sell 5,000 to 10,000 copies, and that's like a very successful record now. And, you know, I came from the machine where you were selling that per week, you know?
Yeah.
And so for me, it's a different mindset. But I think where the industry is going, honestly, we see the downside. We have to get out of the mindset that CDs are going to be around. I think the format is changing.
Yeah.
People are more single oriented. Digital downloads are going to be the reality of the future, you know. And the problem, I think, if you don't mind me mentioning the problem,
please.
In the smooth jazz industry is that, unfortunately, I think the audience doesn't feel like they're connected to a star, you know, if
mm-hmm.
you understand what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
They know the names, but a lot of times in their minds, there is no visible or person that face, you know. So I think the only way to solve that, I think the social media outlet is a great opportunity that I think will expand and help artists to become more visible.
That's why we have artists on our stage, because this is an intimate setting.
And you don't know how much we appreciate you. You have sustained us. I really appreciate you.
Yeah.
That's really nice.
That's really nice. You know? Thank you.
Well,
we're going to try to keep the train rolling, you know?
Man.
Yes.
Yeah, man.
Yes,
well, so. I mean, you know, people always are going to need music. So, I mean, somebody, you know, one way or the other,
it's going
you know,
to
and I'm thinking, a guy like you, you know, if the checks aren't coming in, you're still going to be standing out on the street corner playing this thing. I hope.
Well, I hope not.
I know I'll be standing someplace going, so yeah, traffic and weather next. You know, it's whatever. Yeah. Whatever.
I have a son in college, I tell you. It's like taking on another mortgage. I'm going to have to play on the street for a long time.
There you go. We're going to take a break. This is going so fast.
Know,
it's unbelievable. We're going to take a break. Come back a little bit more with Najee. Stick around here on Breakfast with Gary. Welcome back to Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, everybody.
Mm-hmm.
This has been a real special morning.
Thank you.
Really special morning.
Thank you so much.
Nick, thanks again, too, for joining us here, making this a little bit better. This
you like
is,
our piano?
This is great
I
stuff.
Love it. I love it.
Yeah, man. Well, you can make it sound great. There's no question about that.
Thank you so much.
What are you going to do for us?
Well, we're going to do Spain. We're going to do something. I haven't recorded this other than live. But
nice.
Yeah. We since we have Nick here, I'm going to utilize him because he's
good.
As well, you should.
Right.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. All right, everybody.
Najee.
Thank you.
Thank you, sweetheart. Thank you.
Thank you so very much.
Thank you, my friend.
So much. Love it.
Nick, thank you.
Here's the latest one, The Morning After, a musical love story. Thanks, everybody. The great Najee. Appreciate it. We'll catch you next time on Breakfast with Gary and Kelly. Wow, wow, wow.
Wow, wow, wow.